This is Surrender to Win, a look at what's holding you back from experiencing a life of peace and joy that God intends for us all. Your host is Brian Anderson, the program director and a substance abuse counselor at Rob's Ranch, a Christ-centered residential substance abuse treatment facility for men in Purcell, Oklahoma. This is Surrender to Win.
Hey, and good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to another Friday edition of Surrender to Win. I am your host, Brian Anderson. I'm the program director here at Rob's Ranch. Rob's Ranch is a male-only, Christ-centered substance abuse treatment center. And we're located here in just outside Purcell, Oklahoma. And I am glad to have you guys with us today. I got a good topic, I think, that you're going to be interested in. It's one that I enjoy. And the topic of today's lecture is called the big eye. And that is, dealing with people's ego, dealing with our ego. And you might be surprised at how many of us out there have a big eye ego at times. I work in the substance abuse field. I have the privilege and the blessing of being able to work with men who are battling substance abuse, drug addiction, alcoholism, along with things like codependency and gambling issues and even sex addiction, relationship addictions, pornography, etc. And one of the things that I find that's pretty consistent across the board with the individuals that I work with is that there's an ego there, and there's the big eye. Big eye as in themselves, or if any of this applies to you, it would be to you. And so I wanted to talk about that today, and to give the listeners an opportunity to give yourself an opportunity to see if any of this applies to you. I believe that before we can ever make positive changes to our life that improves our life, we got to kind of be able to maybe identify what some of the problems are with our life. I know, from a personal standpoint of view, from a personal experience, before I myself went through Rob's Ranch a couple years ago for some of my own substance abuse with alcohol and pain medication. I had the big eye. I had a lot of these character defects, these emotional stuff going on that I talk about on this show. And that's one of the reasons why I wanted to do this show, is to try and be 100% transparent with who I am. And to maybe, just maybe, reach one person out there that's struggling with life, that's not doing well, or at least not having the life that they would have liked to have had. And so I try to focus on the things that I've learned, the things that I've experienced, the things I've learned from school, the things I've learned with the clients that I get to work with, and present those once a week on Fridays here on Crossover Radio. And again, hopefully somebody out there can hear something that may inspire them enough to take a look at themselves and start to put the work in to change their life. Guys, listen, I know, life's not always going to be roses and happy and all that. We're all going to have some tough times. We're all going to have emotional pain. But what I've learned over time is there's a tremendous amount of challenges, struggles, pain that we create ourselves just by the very way we think. And so through this process, I hope to be able to point some of those out. So one of the things that we share here at Rob's Ranch, and it's not ours. I mean, we don't patent this, but it's something that I believe, and that is ego. And we say ego stands for edging God out. And I once heard somebody told me, they said, "Hey, Brian, you know what the difference between you and God is?" And I took the bait. I was like, "No, what?" And the individual said, "Well, Brian, the difference is God never tries to play you." And I thought about that for a little while. And they were right. I mean, how often have I tried to play God in this world, in this life, wanting people to live life the way I wanted them to, wanted everything to go the way I wanted it to go. And if it didn't go the way I wanted it to go, and people didn't live life the way I wanted them to live, then I got all kinds of angry, resentful, all those negative emotions. And it was because I was trying to play God. I was trying to say, with the audacity and the arrogance of myself, trying to say, "I know what's best. And if everybody on this planet would just live life according to the way I want them to live, everything would be great." And that was an ego. That was a super inflated ego. And that was me edging God out. And my life was filled with constant anxiety, disappointment, resentment. And bottom line was just, I never was truly happy. And so as I was preparing for this show this week, I was looking at what to do. And I came across this subject matter of the big eye, and I said, "Man, that's going to be a good show." I did defense mechanisms last week, and this kind of goes along with it. There's a little crossover between the defense mechanisms that we use to kind of protect our ego and then the big eye. And so, what is the big eye? And the big eye is a defense that people have that covers up, some six basic human characteristics. And the first one of that that I want to bring out is it's the big eye, that the ego covers up immaturity. Do you know somebody or are you somebody that deals with problems by pouting about it, constantly complaining, throwing adult temper tantrums? When I'm working with clients, I do an assessment for two ages. The first age I do an assessment for is I look at their chronological age. Do they look like they are 35, for instance? I have some individuals that come here and they look 95, and yet chronologically they're 35. And that could be due to the drug and alcohol abuse, the anxiety, the depression. They just look worn out. So they don't look 35, even though that's their chronological age. Now, the second age that I look at and make an assessment on, and I think this is more important, is what is their emotional age? Do they respond to life the way you would expect somebody who was 35 years old emotionally? And what I find out, or what I find, is every person that comes in that I get to work with, emotionally, they're about 14 years old, 13 years old, etc. And so there's a level of immaturity there. And you'll see this by how they respond to not getting what they want, or being told no, or things not going the way they want them to go. They'll pout. They'll sit on the pity pot, constant complaining. They'll throw adult temper tantrums. And an adult temper tantrum really, if you look at a young child who doesn't get the toy that they want at a store or the candy in the grocery store aisle, and they throw a fit. They may yell, they may scream, they may cry. And I've literally seen adults do the same thing. Problem is an adult has a lot more things in their experience level that they can revert to. They revert to violence, they can revert to vindictiveness, they can revert into withdrawing, not speaking to people for long, long, long time, denying things from people. They can throw that adult temper tantrum and not deal with whatever that challenge is, whatever that disappointment is, in an emotionally mature manner. And so emotionally, we are literally dealing with an emotional child. And you'll see that they often don't respond reasonably. Or you'll see the individual that gets incredibly angry over something, and people standing on the outside are like, I don't get it. Why you get so angry about that? And that is, again, going back to an emotional level of immaturity, a emotional child. And that is centered around the ego. In their mind, all life centers around them. Now, intellectually, they may know, the world doesn't revolve around me. But emotionally, they do. And emotionally, they think that they should get what they want. And if they don't, that's when the emotional immaturity kicks in. The next one is inferiority. And I'll talk a little bit about more of that on the other side of this break we're going to take here. And I'll keep going through the rest of the six different characteristics, basic human characteristics, excuse me, that they have as far as when it comes to the big eye. So, hey, come on back after the break, and we'll keep doing this, and we will see you on the other side.
Ah, do you hear that? That means the start of a good day in my household. If I don't have that first cup to begin my morning, then I'm guaranteed my day is going to be a struggle. And nobody makes better coffee than Grounds for Compassion Coffee. It's coffee with conviction. So head on over to their website, g4c.coffee. That's G, the number 4c.coffee. Or give them a call at 405-603-1902 to get your own cup of get up and go.
I just love it out here. It's so peaceful, and you get chills when you come out, and you feel the presence of God, man. And you know, it's something, and the feelings, that's something a lot of us have never had.
Opiates, meth, alcohol, are you addicted? Rob's Ranch is a nonprofit, Christ-based treatment center for men located in central Oklahoma. Rob's Ranch uses proven treatment methods and a program of spiritual growth to give men the opportunity to restore their lives and their relationships. Every member on staff has been there and are now in recovery themselves. If you or a loved one is struggling with addiction to drugs or alcohol, please call 405-253-3838 or find Rob's Ranch on Facebook or online at robsranch.org.
They're just so accepting, so caring. It'll change your life if you're not careful.
You're listening to Surrender to Win with your host, Brian Anderson, on Crossover Radio.
Radio with a purpose.
This world got a way of showing me.
Some days it'll lift you up. And welcome back. It'll call you bluff, man. Most of if you haven't downloaded the new Crossover Radio app yet, well, number one, you're not listening to the show right now on it because we switched streams. But if you're listening to this off the website or maybe Facebook, go to your app store and download the new Crossover Radio app. It's updated. It's got the new stream on it. Makes it real easy to listen to the show, to listen to the radio. You can also find my show on Apple Podcast, Google Play. I've got a Facebook page called Surrender to Win that I post the show afterwards. And you can also listen to the show on Crossover Radio Facebook page as well after it's been posted up. So before we left for the commercial break, I was talking about some of the six basic human characteristics of the big eye, that thing that protects our ego. And the next one, number two, I was talking about is inferiority. And, you know, inferiority, if I can get the word out, inferiority is, that's that individual you see that, man, you know, they really act like they're, you know, a macho man. They're really, really, really tough girl. And they're using all kinds of efforts, you know, things to try to prove to people how tough they are, that, you know, nothing bothers them. And that stems from an actual feeling of inferiority from other people. And they're trying to convince everybody else that they don't have this inferiority feeling. But it never truly convinces themselves. And that goes back to that emotional immaturity. I think and I believe that everybody is going to at some point, sometime, get emotionally hurt over things. They're going to have disappointments. They're going to have loss. They're going to have grief. And when we see somebody who's trying to act like it doesn't bother them, you know, maybe on the surface it they don't think it does. And deep down inside, are they wounded or are they hurt? And we use all kinds of different techniques, different denial. I've talked about denial and the grief here a couple weeks ago. But another one of those characteristics, those defense characteristics, especially with those that hold the big eye, is inferiority. Inside we feel inferior to everybody else. And so we're going to try and project that to everybody else that we're not inferior. And it often comes off over the top. I joke around with the men I work with here, and I say that's the guy that walks around with ILS. And if you don't know what ILS is, ILS stands for Invisible Lat Syndrome. That's the guy that's walking around with his arms stuck way out and chest puffed up. And they're trying to communicate. You know, we communicate more by body language than we do by words, by what we say. And I think I read a statistic, don't hold me to it, but it was something around the neighborhood that 70% of communication that human beings provide is through body language. And that it's the what we say and the tone that we say it in makes up the remaining 30%. And so that tough macho guy, that tough gal persona, that's a defense mechanism. It's a defense wall to keep people from getting in, but it's also a manipulative behavior, trying to show people how they're not inferior to anybody or they're better than anybody. And but deep down inside, from my experience working with people, that's not how they feel inside. The next one I want to talk about is what I refer to as inadequacy. And that kind of goes along with the inferiority. It's tied in with it. But inadequacy says that, you know, we have a fear of being less than, that we're not as good as everybody else. And so we reject other people's ideas. We don't want to listen to what other people have to say. We might hear them, but we're not going to listen. We may be given great advice on how to do something, but we won't do it. We're going to do it our way. And that's usually have a feeling of inadequacy. And a feeling that if I somehow take other people's advice and I take their help, if somebody gives me a piece of advice on how to do something and I use that, that'll make me inadequate. I won't be good enough. I got to be the best. I have to be the best at everything. Nobody else can be better than me. And if anybody else is better than me, I start throwing all kinds of emotional, immature, adult temper tantrums. I could go into the pouting, the complaining, the manipulating. And all of that stems from a deep feeling of being inadequate, not being good enough with just the way we are. Listen, I believe that every single one of us, we are good enough just the way God made us. It has nothing to do with, you know, what we've done, what we've accomplished, how many degrees we have, how much money is in our bank account, what neighborhood we live in, what kind of car we drive, our clothes, our job status, our titles. Look, I lived the life. I did 22 years in the Army, and my sole identity was the Army. It was my uniform. It was what rank I had on. Everything that I wrapped up my self-worth in was surrounded with the Army. That was my identity. And so I constantly had this deep feeling of being inadequate, that I had to be the best at everything, and I had to have an answer for everything. And I couldn't accept people's help, or at least let them know I was accepting them help, because then somehow that would mean that I was weak or I was inadequate and didn't have the answer. And that created all kinds of problems with not admitting to when I didn't know something or trying to figure something out and struggling with it and not being able to accomplish it. The list goes on and on and on. But the bottom line was, is no matter how successful I was in the Army, what I had done, whatever ribbon or badge or whatever I was presented with, deep down inside, I still did not feel adequate enough. I felt very inadequate inside. I can't tell you exactly why. I don't think there is one specific reason why. It just is. That's just how it was with me. And over the time that I have been a therapist and gone to school and been privileged with working with people, I've all these things that I talk about on here, I've experienced myself, but I don't today. And it took a whole lot of work, and it took a whole lot of emotional uncomfortableness, a whole lot of pain, emotional pain, to get through this stuff. We have a saying here that you have to feel to heal. We're not going to get out of this. If we want to be free from the pain, if we want to be free from the emotional struggles, we're going to have to feel it. I believe, you know, God gave us the ability to feel for a reason. And we try to avoid all those uncomfortable feelings. I understand it. I get it. Pain equals relief-seeking behaviors. Now, with the clientels that I work with, their relief-seeking behaviors were centered around drugs and alcohol. But I also get an opportunity to observe families, friends, people out in society, and they're not excluded from the relief-seeking behaviors either. Now, a lot of people have healthy relief-seeking behaviors, which could be talking to somebody, going to a therapist, appropriately exercising, reading, getting out in nature, all kinds of things. Those are healthy ways of seeking relief from emotional pain. But those can also become problematic as well. And so human beings are going to search for relief from emotional pain. They're going to search for relief from physical pain. That's why we go to the doctor. And without exception, as I've said before on the show, when I've asked people what is worse, physical pain or emotional pain, and without exception, everyone always says emotional pain. It hurts the worst. It permeates every cell of our body, and it can last a lifetime if we don't do anything about it. So just because we go into relief-seeking behavior whenever we feel pain, especially emotional pain, it's not always bad. And the alcoholic and the drug addict is no different. All they were doing was searching for relief from emotional pain. It may have even started off, like in my case, I had some physical injuries, some pretty significant physical injuries that began a pretty heavy use of pain medication to deal with the physical pain. But what I learned is that it really helped out with the emotional pain that I was experiencing from multiple combat tours and a whole bunch of other stuff throughout my life. And at some point I crossed over from, you know, just taking the medication to now the medication was I was using it to relieve the deeper, more painful emotional pain. And then it became problematic. And then, you know, started mixing alcohol with that. And it just turned into a real nightmare. And I know there's individuals out there today listening who have experienced the same thing or are experiencing the same thing right now with themselves or a family member. And it goes all the way back to me trying to protect my ego and feeling inadequate and inferior and then having emotional immaturity on top of that, not knowing how to handle my emotions in a mature manner. And I for people that know me, they know some of the things I went through and they know where I'm at today. And there was no quick fix. There was no instantly, hey, do this and you're going to be fine. You're going to be great. And even to this day, I still work on things to improve my emotional maturity and to improve my overall sense of well-being, to improve my conscious contact with God, to improve my spiritual life. It takes work. We're going to work one way or the other. We're going to work at staying miserable and trying to figure a way out, or we're going to work on getting better by figuring a way out, by doing something. But one way or the other, we're going to work. And so when we hold on to the big I, I'm the center of the universe, these basic human characteristics, these big eye defense human characteristics are what we're typically going to see either in ourselves or in somebody else. And it just creates nothing but more anxiety, pain, depression, lack of self-satisfaction. The list goes on. The whole world is filled with it. I couldn't even begin to tell you how many people go to the doctor because they don't feel good, and here you go, have some antidepressants. They don't address what is causing it. I understand there are individuals out there that truly have a chemical imbalance in the brain, and it causes depressed feelings and all the things that go with that. But there's a tremendous percentage of people out there that are what I consider situationally depressed. And there's an underlying emotional state, an underlying something going on that is resulting in these negative feelings. And if we would actually address the underlying stuff, the negative feelings would start to go away. But it takes work and it takes time. And there's just no shortcut. So hey, we're going to take a break. And when we come back, I'll finish up the last half of the Big Eye and some of those defense, six basic human characteristics that we see with individuals that hold on to the Big Eye. So we'll be back here shortly. I hope you come back and join us. And we'll talk to you right after the break. You're listening to Surrender to Win
on Crossover Radio.
Radio with a purpose.
Are you a small business looking to enter the advertising market without breaking your budget? Well, I've got the solution to your problem. Crossover Radio. We are an internet radio station with worldwide reaching possibility, but locally embedded in the Bethany and War Acres area in Oklahoma. We have competitive advertising packages to help you reach new customers and grow your business. If you're a well-established business, we're here for you as well. We're able to handle all the advertising needs your business requires. We're also launching a crossover radio sports station in May of 2019 that will cover pro, high school sports, and everything in between, doubling your reach and advertising capabilities. To partner with Crossover Radio and grow your business, please contact us at contact@thecrossoveronline.com or by phone at 405-494-0234. Crossover Radio, radio with a purpose.
I just love it out here. It's so peaceful, and you get chills when you come out, and you feel the presence of God, man. And, you know, it's something, and the feelings, that's something a lot of us have never had.
Opiates, meth, alcohol, are you addicted? Rob's Ranch is a nonprofit, Christ-based treatment center for men located in central Oklahoma. Rob's Ranch uses proven treatment methods and a program of spiritual growth to give men the opportunity to restore their lives and their relationships. Every member on staff has been there and are now in recovery themselves. If you or a loved one is struggling with addiction to drugs or alcohol, please call 405-253-3838 or find Rob's Ranch on Facebook or online at robsranch.org.
They're just so accepting, so caring. It'll change your life if you're not careful.
You're listening to Surrender to Win with your host, Brian Anderson, on Crossover Radio.
Radio with a purpose.
Hey, I just want to tell everybody out there listening, old song here, back around my time frame when I was younger, Alanis Morissette, thank you. I just want to tell you guys, hey, thank you for tuning in, listening to my show. I know you guys have got all kinds of stuff that you could be doing with your time and with your life. And to take an hour out of your life to listen to what I got to say and to listen to my opinions, I really appreciate it. I'm really grateful for it. I just hope that it could help somebody someday, somewhere. So, before we went on the break, I was finishing up on some of the six basic human characteristics of what I call the big I. And we were talking about the feelings of inadequacy. The next one I want to talk about is the feelings of insecurity. We see that a lot with individuals who feel anxious. They don't feel safe. They may be in a crowd of people, and that creates a lot of anxiety. They don't feel like they fit in. They don't feel safe. And we may think that nobody cares, nobody understands. And that results, or that relates back to the emotional immaturity again as well. Now, with alcoholics and drug addicts, we say that they stop growing emotionally. They stop maturing emotionally at the age that they start to take their first drinks and drugs. And how this works is, whenever I'm feeling emotionally in pain, anxiety, fear, some of those common things that everybody's going to experience, and I get exposed to a psychoactive substance, a chemical that changes the way I feel, makes me feel better, gives me euphoria, whatever that looks like, marijuana, alcohol, opiates, amphetamine, stimulants, sedatives, all of it. When I get exposed to that and it changes the way I feel, especially if I'm not feeling emotionally well, I start to make a connection. And that connection is, hey, I don't feel good. Take a substance. I feel better. And then the next time we do that, that's what we call a reinforcing behavior. We do it and it works again. And now all of a sudden I'm realizing that, man, I don't have to really do anything other than take a substance and I'll start to feel better. And so we stop emotionally growing. We stop emotionally maturing because we don't need to. We have a substance. We have a chemical. We have a product. We have a behavior. If you're into the cross addictions, whether that's gambling or relationships, pornography, sexual relationships, it changes the way we feel. And so I don't have to continue to emotionally grow. And I get stuck at whatever age that was that I started doing that substance or those behaviors. And so I may have these feelings of insecurity and not knowing how to deal with it. And we need constant reassurance that we're important. I will be, the first to admit to you that this one was a big one with me. I constantly felt insecure about myself. And so I constantly needed reassurance from people, whether it was my wife, my children, my boss, my friends. I needed reassurance from them that I was good enough and that I was doing well. And so I would say things. I would put my sentences together. I would do my behaviors. I would do something so somebody could see me do it, hoping that they'd come back and say, hey, great job. I needed that constant reassurance that I was important, that I was good. And that all stemmed from feeling insecure about myself. And I had that big eye. All I could think about was me. I would act like I was unselfish, but at the end of the day, all I could really think about was me. And I was, my ego was enormous, edging God out. I was in the center of the universe, but I felt so insecure. People have asked me, gee, Brian, you've accomplished this and you've done that and you've got these, three master's degrees and all of these things. How could you still feel insecure? I don't know. I just did. And it was miserable. So Emotional immaturity is also seen in insecurity about things. The next one is impulsivity. You know, we don't think about things. We just rush into things. We're very, very impulsive. I want what I want, and I want it now. I want what I want when I want it, and I want it now. We want our needs to be met now. We want that immediate gratification. I want to know the answer now. I want the success now. I don't want to wait. I demand to have it now. And if I don't get it now, I'm going to try and manipulate to get it now. I'm going to try anything I can to get what I want right now. I'm impulsive. I make irrational decisions. I work with people and I ask them, why did you do that? And sometimes the response, I don't know, I just did it. And sometimes that's true. They just impulsively responded to something. However, if you slow them down and you slow down enough to be able to look at yourself where they can look at themselves, we'll find that why they did something, why they were so impulsive about it, goes all the way deep into that I want it now. I want the instant gratification now. I want the instant success now. I'm going to look for shortcuts so I can get it now. And that just wreaks havoc. It's just devastating to the people around us. And it's devastating and annoying and irritating to ourselves. And we just keep doing it. I remember going, man, I'm just not going to do that. I'm not going to respond that way anymore. And I would. And I know it drove my family and my friends crazy when I did that stuff. The next one, the last one in this these six basic characteristics is insensitivity. And when we come back for this last break, I'll talk about insensitivity and what that looks like. And then I'll go into the last little bit of some of the three basic cells that we have. And you should be able to find yourself in one of these three. We all do. And I've actually have found myself at one time in my life in all three of them. But today, I try to live in just one of them. Come on back after the break. You're listening to Surrendered Wins.
Hey, this is Coach Coleman, and I'm the play-by-play voice for your Bethany Broncos. I know there's a lot of guys out there who are trying to kick that nasty tobacco dipping habit, and I know most guys need a little energy boost to try to get them through a long day. And I'm here to give you a solution for both. Grinds coffee pouches. Grinds are coffee-filled pouches infused with your favorite flavors, such as wintergreen, mint, vanilla, and many more. All of the ingredients in Grinds are 100% safe for consumption, and it'll add a pep to your step. So head on over to getgrinds.com and use our promo code CMI15 to get 15% off your order today. Again, that's getgrinds.com and use the promo code CMI15 to get 15% off of your order. It's time to rise and grind with Grinds today.
Whether you need a professional writer to build or expand your online presence, or fresh new designs and new perspective to build your business, where do you start? Sales from the Click Media is committed to telling your story in a way that promotes business growth, consistent branding, and long-term success. So whether you have one or 100 employees, no tale is too small to tell. Call us today at 405 720-620-6200 or visit our website at talesfromtheclickmedia.com.
Jesus and his followers are in the world. Don't take them out. The world will perish. They are salt. They are light. Keep them there with all its mess and all its confusion. Keep them there. But don't let them be of the world.
They want it. Me to get it in their frame. Four corners all the same. If I never let go of that mold, then it's out in vain. Second grade, a reckless slave every day. Swept away and hoping people's love would never change. Tried to please everyone but God. Yeah, I put up guards. But inside I was dying, finding out life is hard. I remember I cried until my nose was raw. My mom was strung out on that alcohol she won't recall. When they told me to tell her bye outside the hospital, my life was out of control. What have I got into? I know my dad got high. Had me looking low. This hurt had me in the dirt, and this garden wouldn't grow.
Hey guys, welcome back to Surrender to Win. This song here is by Dylan Chase. It's a really great song. And I kind of wanted it to play a little bit because the intro of it was, pretty good. I got a chance to meet Dylan Chase here about a year or so ago. He's got a great story. Grew up in an alcoholic, drug-addicted home, both parents, and how he struggled with life. And today he's turned his life around, and he's making music, God-filled Christian music, telling his story, trying to help people. And it's a pretty cool thing. I've talked about this in previous shows, and I want to reiterate it, because I do focus a lot on drugs and alcohol, and working with people with that, because that's what I do for a living, and I'm in recovery myself from substance abuse. And one of the things that I used to think about alcoholics and drug addicts is they were defective people. They were morally corrupt. They weren't good people. They just didn't grow up in a good family. They this is just a choice. They deserve all of this. They're just not good people. Man, that couldn't be further from the truth. What I've learned is that they're hurting people. They're hurting deep down inside. Yeah, the behaviors that somebody in active addiction does is just mind-boggling and devastating and destructive, and it destroys families, and it destroys children, and it destroys spouses, parents. But it doesn't preclude the fact that they're hurting inside. And they're a human being just like all of us are human beings. And they're the same. They have the same father. They're children of God. Just like we are. And when I found myself on the backside of addiction, I had to realize that, I wasn't a piece of junk. I wasn't a piece of trash. I was a person that was hurting really bad inside. And it wasn't anybody's fault. It wasn't my parents' fault. It wasn't my wife's fault. It wasn't the army's fault. It wasn't the wars that I was in's fault. It was life. And I was hurt. And if you've never been there, all I can tell you is that is a suffering and a misery that is just indescribable. But by the grace of God and through recovery and through other people, I am blessed to live a life of that's just completely, it's indescribable. It's amazing. It's filled with peace and joy and love and all the things that I used to think were, wimpy stuff. I'm a man. I don't need to think about those things and believe in those things. That's not for tough people. And there's going to be people out there that are always going to feel that way. And they're going to listen to me. They're going to listen to the show. And they're going to say all kinds of negative things. And I'm okay with that. Knock yourself out. I know where I was at. And I know where I'm at today. And I'm so grateful for the struggles that I've endured. And everything that I had to go through to get to where I'm at today. And there's not enough money in the world that I would take to go back and change any of that, other than I wish I wouldn't have hurt some of the people that I hurt, my wife and my children, along this journey. But by the grace of God, I don't hurt them anymore. And I don't hurt myself anymore. And so, you know, the alcoholic addict out there is not a bad person. They're not morally corrupt. Their behaviors are atrocious. But they themselves as a human being are not. And we really have one or two choices. We either do something to help our fellow man out, or we live like the rest of the world, and we shove people out, and we ostracize them, and we point fingers at them, and we use the big eye, and we use, you know, how we're superior over other people, and we have this false belief that somehow I'm better than somebody else. That's an option too. And I lived that way for a long time. And today, I choose to look at every human being the best of my ability as no better and no worse than me. Just another human being, another child of God who has the same struggles that everybody else has. So the last one I want to talk about of these six basic human characteristics of the big eye defense is insensitivity. And insensitivity, we see that individual who appears not to care for anybody else. They have no care for others. They do as they please. They rebel against parents, against school, against the law. Their feelings are hurt really, really easy. And they typically will only do something for others if there's something that they're going to get out of it themselves. And that's the person who is displaying that insensitivity. And insensitivity boils down to, what the center of that is, goes back to what this whole topic today was talking about, and that's that big eye. I'm the most important thing on the face of this planet. Everybody out there in the world needs to serve me. There's times when I go into public and I look at individuals' behavior, because that's what I do. And I might be at a nice restaurant. I might be at some type of conference or event. And I like to watch other people, and I like to see how they interact with other people, especially when I'm in restaurants. And I'll watch people who are just insensitive, angry, bitter, demanding, abrasive, arrogant people in the way they talk to the wait staff, other people around, as though that they... just by them breathing air, they deserve to be waited on in a manner that is above and over the top from what is acceptable behavior. And, you know, those are some of the behavioral things that we see in people that have some of these big eye characteristics. They think they're the center of the universe. But make no mistake about it, what's truly going on inside that individual is not that they are some great person. Their ego has edged God out. They believe that they're the center of the universe, that life revolves around them for whatever reason. Well, maybe it's their accomplishments or their money or their social status, whatever it may be. But it's all a lie. and it's not genuine. And I promise you, there is internal anxiety and struggle within those individuals, whether they ever admit to it, whether they'll ever own up to it, and sometimes whether they'll ever take the time to recognize it. And that's the big I. Look, there's three basic selves that people have. There's their ideal self. That's who and what they'd like to be. You know, you have that image in your head of what you'd like to be. That's the ideal self. That's what, you know, when I'm looking at myself and I picture myself in the future and where I'll be and where my status is or my job or my house or money, bank account, whatever that is. That's the ideal self. And then we have the perceived self. And that's who we think we are. That's what we think we are. And that can be either I think I'm a piece of trash with low self-esteem and I'm not worthy and I'm not good, I'm nothing, I'm useless. Or it could be the opposite of that, where people will think they are overly important, where they think they are better than other people. But that's the perceived self. And then the last one is the real self. And that is who we really are, what we really are. Now, I lived in the ideal self and the perceived self my whole life. Until I finally was brought to my knees because of alcohol and medication abuse. And through recovery and treatment and finding a true relationship, a true spiritual relationship with Jesus Christ, I finally discovered my real self. I finally decided or found who I was and what I was. And I will tell you that my real self was so far better and is so far better than my ideal self ever was, than my perceived self ever was. Somebody asked me once before I got in recovery, they said, "Brian, what's your purpose here in life?" And I had a bunch of textbook answers. I had a bunch of, well, you know, I'm here, especially when I was in the Army. I'm here to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all foreign enemies, or against all enemies, foreign and domestic. And I believed it. That was my purpose. But then what happened was after I retired from the Army, that purpose was over. The Army wasn't going to call me back up and say, "Hey, man, we need you to come back and do your job again." It was done. And I had no purpose. And that began a long journey of self-discovery and misery and pain and ultimately work. And the result was unbelievable. It's where I'm at today. And so now I live in my real self. And that's all I want to live, is in my real self. I don't want to put up an image. I don't want to put up a front. I don't want to live in that big eye anymore. I don't want to have that huge ego anymore. And my ideal self today is my real self. And it is such a wonderful feeling. Hey, listen, I greatly appreciate you guys tuning in today. I hope you guys will continue to listen next week on the show. And I hope you guys, if you're not doing well and you have some challenges, man, take a risk. Do something.
If you or someone you know is struggling with substance abuse, call Rob's Ranch today, 405-253-3838.
Online at robsranch.org or find him on Facebook at Rob's Ranch.